liability itself was made back in February. Mm-hmm. So we're already many months on since the actual determination of liability for costs was ordered. And our clients as the receiving party feel that already this is something that we feel could have progressed more quickly, and we would like finality to the assessment. There has already been, albeit belatedly, a payment into court of half of the amount claimed in the cost assessment. And we would say that, I'll address the court later on in response to the application on proportionality and overriding objective. But in summary, we are here today, originally listed for the cost assessment hearing, and my friend sort of, perhaps I would say, hijacked the hearing on a 2-hour basis to hear his application. I don't really want to say much more than to have brought to the attention of the court the time it's taken to reach this point and how our clients feel that it is something that just needs to be progressed and an adjournment, should there be one, would not be said.
But let's not preempt the application.
Sure, no, certainly. That was really my summary, so just to let you know who we are and what we're here for. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bowden, your application.
Yes, may I please, Your Honour. Councillor Dennis Bowden. I appear to first two respondents in relation to this matter. If I might approach the registrar, sir, I have a bundle of correspondence. My learned friend doesn't object to this going in.
So, Hutchison, you've got a copy?
I do.
And simply put, sir, there'll be a little discussion over the bundle of indices, sir. When it arrived yesterday afternoon, it didn't have the correspondence I hoped for. I put it together last night, and there it is.
How long do you think you need to introduce the application?
I'm thinking I'm going to take half an hour, sir.
I have read it.
Right.
So, I tell you, why don't you stick to the main points of your application, and then we'll have it in about 10 minutes. Let's have a response in about 5 or 6 minutes, and then if we need more, I'll have a look at it. It's not a complex application. From my point of view, I understand the points that you're making. So if you could try and aim for about 10 to 15 minutes maximum, that would be helpful.
Extremely difficult for me to do that.
I'm sure you can.
My very best to oblige. Well, if you want to go to the absolute main points here, mm-hmm. I could not help but observe my learned friend described the documents which came yesterday, the disbursements, as a bill of costs, so as part of the bill of costs.
Yeah.
They would form part of the bill of costs, but we didn't get a bill of costs, sir, and despite repeatedly asking for it, and in fact, I listed three occasions, but in fact,
yes.
I'll draw to your attention.
Your position is it's a statement of costs, and it's not a bill of costs. It's filed in accordance with the wrong part of the rules.
Rule 40.5, brackets 2, sir, says that it should be a bill of costs. The document itself says it's a statement of costs.
Yeah.
A bill of costs is normally a distinct document. That's set out in, I have indeed, as Your Honour would have seen, sir, with reference to the decision of Justice Williams and Al-Fatah, that the procedure is, sir, it's like a waterfall procedure, I think it's called. You go down looking for sources of law, and at the end, sir, it's quite permissible to apply to the guide and the rules, sir, and that be taken as a white book. When we go to the white book, sir, we see exactly what a bill of costs is.
True, but let's move beyond technicalities into the realities.
Yes.
The reality was, on 26th of June, you got pretty much all that you would ever have in a bill of costs. You got the information that you would normally have in a bill of costs on the 26th of June, which was 3 months ago.
Well, with respect to no.
So tell me what's different between the 26th of June submission and what you would expect in a bill of costs.
Absolutely, sir. And if we go to the appendix A to my submissions, sir, it's a claimant's bill of costs. That's the form for a bill of costs, sir. And what we have, sir, doesn't reflect that at all. Plus, and I didn't include it there, sir.
But what data, Mr.? We're not
going to
worry too much about the technical details are not something that our court focuses on. Our court focuses on, have you had sufficient time to analyse the information you need in order to respond to it? So 3 months ago, it seems to me as if all of the information one might ordinarily expect from a bill of costs was provided. That would have been a good juncture to say, no, it's not in the right format, it's not in the right tabular format. But tell me what you're missing from 26th of June that didn't allow you to do it.
The schedules of what time was spent, by whom, when, on what occasions. And that is just completely absent from this bill of costs.
From the statement of costs.
Statement of costs.
I accept that, and I'm with
you on
that.
It is completely missing.
26th of June.
I did raise that point, and it's in tab 12 of the bundle, sir, at point 4, and in the reply submission.
Yeah,
not tab 12, sir.
No, I understand. It has been raised. You have raised it.
Yes, sir.
But that's okay. That's why we didn't listen to the application.
Indeed.
But the point is that the information, I think the better point that you've made in your submission is we don't have sufficient information in the statement of costs in order to be able to appropriately respond and to consider whether something was reasonable and proportionate, which is our test. But the response to that, it would appear to me, is that all of the information you would ordinarily expect to get in a bill of costs was, albeit latterly, albeit not at the same time, but was ultimately presented 3 months ago to you. So what you need to help me with is, what didn't you have 3 months ago that you asked for, and which means that you're not in a position to deal with costs today?
Exactly, sir. Well, and indeed I am, sir.
Thank
if you go through to the page 44 of the bundle.
Yeah.
Now this is document filed by our side, sir, in June, okay, after the receipt of the statement of costs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The statement of costs is included in the bundle of pages under tab 11, pages 60, let's see. There, sir, we said, and if I take you through to, I think, paragraph 4, we raised the absolute point. Doesn't comply, sir. It's non-compliant. And it's the schedules. So, yes, it follows an allocation of time towards the groups, but it does not include the schedules. And one might expect, and I've listed it there, paragraphs 13 through to 20, sir, attendances upon valid capital, okay, no stated basis for 18 and a half hours on valid capital. Attendances upon opponents, no stated basis for this allocation, 10 and a half hours.
Could you turn to page 49 of the bundle for me?
Certainly.
Do you see the section there, attendances on valid capital?
Mm-hmm.
What I'm referring to is this information.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's what I would expect to see in a cost submission connected to a bill of costs, albeit that this looks to be printed off an internal system. This is the breakdown we would ordinarily review in terms of time, rate, and detail.
Again, sir, it's done in an entirely summary basis, and that is the difficulty.
So how would you expect to see more information in a bill of costs?
In terms of the schedule, sir,
yeah,
we would expect to see the individual items listed. And there's a subsidiary report, sir, and that is a very substantial one in most people's. And that is that the point, sir, that you cannot get costs when you are in breach of the rules.
Let's come on to that.
Right.
Let's come on to that. Let's stick to this point.
Yes.
If you turn to your example of a bill of costs,
yes, sir.
And I'm looking at the doesn't page 11. Which starts at the top, engaged in court, 3 hours, £576. Engaged in conference, 1.5 hours, £288. Travel and waiting, 1.5 hours, £288. Why is that less detailed than page 49 of the June submission?
Well, so the June submission does not break it down into the individual items. It doesn't say when it was spent, when that time was spent, and on what it was spent. It just groups it together.
I'm with you. So it's not date specific?
It's not date specific. And when it comes to the subsidiary point, so that's vital.
I see. Thank you.
And if we come back, sir, to the submission that I made in June, this is a hearing, sir, that took between one quarter and one half of one day. So it was, on any view, sir, a pretty simple application. In fact,
well, let's not move on to quantum before we. So your point is that you don't have. It is your point that you don't have sufficient information because you're missing the relevant dates on which time was incurred to be able to deal with the assessment of cost today.
Yes.
Okay.
Various communications with council, including meetings, telephone attending, conferences, and emails. I'm looking at page 51, 5.5 hours. With respect, sir, for a quarter day, we can't analyse that.
Well,
we're moving away from the very funny.
In a sense, that plays into your court because we're assessing today on a standard basis, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
So, any doubts found in your favour as the paying party?
I accept that, sir. But we. If you like, for our own reasons, wish to go for a detailed review of the expenditure here. And we put up a good point, sir, that indisputably, we say, the applicants were breaching the rules right up to the end of the hearing. And in fact, we say beyond.
So should we come on to that point?
Yes.
Next. Now, can I tidy up one other issue?
Absolutely.
Which was, have you now been provided a copy of council's fee notes for $40,000?
Yes, I have,
okay.
Sir.
Have done.
But that came in yesterday at probably lunchtime.
About the same time as your application?
I did. I haven't really made excuse for that.
No, that's okay. All right. So the point we want to move on to now, your second point, was a principle of law, which, if I've understood it, says that you can't recover costs for a period when you're in breach.
Yes, sir.
So could you talk to me about that?
Well, if we look, sir, and I'll come back to my before we move on from that point, sir, where I said I had set out three, sir, occasions when Code & Co. had been asked for this information. There were, in fact, in a review of matters before, and one could, that's in paragraph 11D of my submissions. And in the billing email correspondence, sir, tab 11, sorry, in the billing email correspondence, sir, under tab 2,
yeah.
We have an additional letter, sir, dated.
Mm-hmm.
The 21st of September,
mm-hmm.
And it does, was, you know, go on to cover a lot of the same points.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Hutchison says, look, liability for costs is determined by that order, when in fact, so we say, what the order for costs did was reflect the overall success of the claimant in the application.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't deal with the point that we wish to make, sir, and that is that the application was brought in breach of the rules, and so there ought to be a further consequent reduction upon that. And then, sir, the costs. I just copied out the part of the order it was to cost. And on the second page, it's page 7 of the bundle as you're looking at it.
Which bundle? Your application?
Sorry, the correspondence bundle.
Correspondence bundle.
Yeah. But another one, email correspondence bundle.
Yeah.
Page 7 of that. Still on tab 2, so over the page. It said, we simply ask that the claimant be ordered to supply the information. And it didn't happen, sir. And what the information was asked, that was asked for, sir, was copies of all correspondence between client and Carbon Register. And the point I'm just about to come to, sir, is that this application was born in a bit of a rush, but our view is that the gestation was considerably longer than that. And so we want that information. We say we're entitled to it on these points. B, the correspondence establishing we applied and co-engaged counsel. And simply, sir, there's just been a refusal to provide that information. And we've now got counsel's bill as of yesterday. With respect, sir, I haven't had a chance to A, analyse the bill, and B, consider the legal issues which surround it. And it's a summary bill, sir, dated after the event. It doesn't give me any of the information I really seek. And I understand, sir, that there are issues to do with the examination of counsel's bill of costs, or fee notes, sorry, being examined in court, and that counsel ought to be apprised of the situation before they are examined in court. I'm actually not familiar with those authorities, sir, and since yesterday, we've got a lot of balls in the air, sir, and I just haven't had time to
can I see a copy of counsel's fee notes?
Yes, sir. It should be. My learning friend handed it up.
So I have a copy.
Thank you.
For the court. It was sent yesterday by email, but we would advise that you should present a hard copy for the file.
Thank you.
With the tab and paginated also.
Page 75.
There we go, sorry.
Should add that the tab includes court fee disbursement.
I should have noticed.
Flies first class, does he?
Mr. Reeves, sir? No, I believe business.
Okay, thank you.
And frankly, sir, I don't know what to say about that invoice, and that fee note, sorry, and I'm not going to make any criticism of it now, because it would be inappropriate to do so. I want to make that quite clear. But we obviously seem to reserve that position on it, I'm not going to make any criticism of the amount of counsel's fee without what I consider to be very good grounds to do so, and so I don't. But we do. It's come very, very late in the day, sir, and we simply haven't been in a position to deal with it. And it doesn't include the information which we actually sought, which was when did this engagement start? And it might be, sir, that Mr. Reed might deign to provide that information. Again, sir, I'm quite unsure of a more on this, but I'm not sure if he has to.
And look, his fee notes, it's a flight. And then a brief fee.
Yes.
So that's not an unusual.
No, it's not.
No.
But indeed, sir, I'm involved in the CFI 026 2009 cost assessment, which was started now, sir. And I can tell you, sir, that we are presenting detailed bills of costs on behalf of our council and of our council's clerks have been working for many days on making sure that that's all in order, sir. So there may be an information requirement that is more greater than that. I don't know, and I'm loath to launch any criticism other than as to the very late arrival of the documentation. And so it might be said that the late arrival of that documentation is in fact a belated recognition that, that what was presented was not a bill of costs, because a bill of costs requires, as part of the bill of costs, any note of counsel to be attached to it. There's another very important
thing. It wasn't a bill of costs. Don't spend time. What was presented was a statement of costs.
Exactly.
It was not a bill of costs. What we're trying to understand, and the first
yes.
point that you made was, what are you missing
yes.
That you didn't get in June? And your point is, I don't have date-specific entries. So
and
you've dealt with that.
I didn't until yesterday yeah. have a fee note of counsel.
Understood. But there's no surprise in fee note for counsel.
There is, with respect to this, there is actually a very interesting surprise overall in the disbursements. And if I can turn to, take you on just through to the very last document in the bundle.
I was just going to notify the court of the time I was on.
Yeah, thanks.
The very last bundle of documents, sir, is an email from me yesterday on receipt of this. And again, sir, the statement of costs produced in May, sir, had disbursements, 40,000, no more.
Mm-hmm.
Yesterday, we get the documents, and they are, sir, that you, I think you've been handed them up, sir, 75A, 75B. 75C, 75D, and 75E, and they were attached, sir, to an email from a Mr. Leggett, who's employed by
mm-hmm.
the claimant's solicitor, sir. There, sir, Mr. Leggett, does anyone have that email?
No, I'm looking at counsel's fee note.
Ah, well, I'm moving on to a related but slightly different thing. If I might.
Let's go point by point because it's confusing enough.
I'm sorry.
So it's the second point is you can't recover costs when you're in breach of the rules. So that I haven't heard submissions on that yet.
Okay. What Your Honour drew my attention to the fee note before I moved
Understood.
On. Understood. And then which reminded me that there were a couple more points that I should have dealt with. And that is the statement of costs is also deficient because it does not have it's the indemnity declaration which goes at the end in accordance with Article 7 of the Registrar's Cost Direction, I think of 2000.
Mm-hmm.
We've got it here, sir. In Article 7 of the Registrar's Cost Direction, sir. And that's also absent, sir. And so, and that's an important matter, that there's no other arrangements with the lawyers which might reduce their fees. That, sir, I don't want to go off into completely extraneous matters, but that could be extremely relevant, sir, in the context of the wider 036 bar 3 application which is being undertaken now. So where's relatively serious accusations.
So this is the requirement that any cost summary or bill of costs must include a statement signed by a registered practitioner that the bill accurately reflects the amounts which the client is liable to pay and that there are no arrangements in place which will reduce the amounts due and payable by the client dependent on the outcome of the cost assessment. You're saying it's deficient because of that?
Doesn't
matter. Okay, thank you.
And it's not just a make like points.
No.
It's a serious point, and if one looks as I anticipate Your Honour has at the 036 bar 3 application, which is for before His Excellency Justice Mahan at the moment, there's some pretty serious accusations flying around in that case, in respect of which the judgment is yet to be issued.
Let's move on to the reasons why you think that costs are not recoverable when in breach of the rules.
Well, sorry, just to try your patience one little bit more, sir. The documents which were received yesterday, sir, and that is documents 75A, 75B, 75C. Now, A, B, C, and D, sir, might seem pretty unremarkable on the face of it. However, what is remarkable, and I deal with it, Sarah, in the bundle of correspondence at page 32, is the, and one was not quite sure if it's submission or evidence which accompanied the document said, but nevertheless, so what did accompany it was an email from Mr. Rhys Leggett, and I'm wondering if Your Honour has seen it, and if not, I might encourage the registrar to.
I should that.
It said there, sir, that the disbursements add up to $40,000,
yeah,
and that, sir, matches the sum set out, but not broken down in any way until yesterday,
yeah,
in the statement of costs. However, sir, when if you go down to council's fees, sir, it says there, and it purports to say that council's fees of GP British Pound 22,904.66 equals $36,476. As I set out in paragraph at page 32, sir, when I did the sums yesterday on yesterday's conversion, sir, it came to 35,423.
Okay, I think that doesn't support your first point or your second point. We'll come on to it if we do the detailed cost assessment. But you're still, you've got minutes to complete your application, and you're yet to move on to why you can't recover costs when in breach of the rules.
Right. Why can't you recover costs when you're in breach of the rules, sir? Is a very simple point, sir. That is, if you are in breach of the rules, you should not. It's a relevant matter to take into account, sir, when assessing costs. And,
yep,
and we can't start that application, sir, until we get the detailed report. And I have, sir, set that out.
Do you refer, which is the rule you rely upon which says that the conduct of the receiving party should bear sway over the.
I think it is 40 other matters, sir, and I think that is 43.536, sir. It's other matters.
Which rule?
So my apologies, I'll just. Sorry, sir, when my learned friend speaks, I'll look that up and bring that to your attention, but it comes under, I had mentioned it somewhere in my submissions, and I'm sorry, I've quite forgotten where I did and what it was, sir, but I think it's rather than 35, sir, other matters can be taken into account in assessing costs. And that brings in the conduct of the parties.
38.8 deals with. That's when deciding what order to make as to cost. Let's look at, there must be something on quantum.
Yes, there is, sir, and I apologise, but I'll bring it back.
So it's 38.23.
Thank you. I see.
If that's what my friend is.
Yes.
Yes, and
okay.
It is a yes.
All right, thank you.
And then, sir, indeed, under if one goes through the white book, and
we don't need to. I think we're okay. 38.23. So you're saying that their conduct insofar as the way that they submitted the wrong form and then followed it up in June with enough information but not as much as you need, and then the late delivery of council's fee note and the seeming incongruity between the rates applied and the rates that you have, all should lead us to a reduction in the amounts paid.
Well, and sir, the way that the hearing was presented on the 6th of November, because on the hearing on the 6th of November took off in this way, sir, at 11 a.m. On the 3rd of November, the proceedings were served. The hearing, sir, was on the Thursday at 2 p.m. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Whilst that is the, whilst Sir 72 hours had passed,
mm-hmm.
3 clear days had not, and that's the difference. And I've set it out rather
yes.
in the beginning of the submission there, Sir, that the first day and the last day were excluded. It's really as simple as that. From the computation of time. So, if you serve it on Monday, you can't count the Monday, and nor can you count the day of hearing.
Mm-hmm.
So only the Tuesday and Wednesday. That's 2 clear days, it's not 3.
Yeah.
Now, does that matter? Well, yes, it most certainly does matter, because it's got two very serious consequences. Number one is the obvious one, that a law firm such as HAS, which is really only just getting to grips with the fire, and I think that was pretty obvious from the conduct of the hearing, that HAS weren't in control of the fire. So they had a third less time to prepare, sir. It was exacerbated, sir, by the fact that the bundle for the hearing, sir, was only delivered on the 5th, so which is half a day before the hearing. And so it gets worse, sir.
This is your point on conduct?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And this is the breach. This is the primary breach of the rules. Yes, there have been breaches since then which ought to impact on costs, and indeed the cost of this hearing. But the primary breach as to why that 50% should be further reduced and then the cost is risky. So we say, for example, sir, His Honour reduced the cost to 50%. That reflected the success, the relative success of the parties at the hearing. His Honour's judgment certainly didn't deal with this point, and we're quite free to bring it up now. So that deserves a further reduction, maybe to say 25%, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So you're then looking at 25%. Then, sir, you consider the reasonableness of that against the total time allocations, but you get awarded a quarter of it.
Understood.
And our point is, we're just not in a position to start that exercise. We don't, for example, sir, we don't know when of this $116,000 of costs for half a hearing at the most, when did it start? When did the preparation start? We would say that on balance, all the way up to the conduct of the hearing, halfway through, until His Excellency actually granted abridgment of time against the protests of the claimants here, who said that they didn't need it, it was 72 hours was enough. Until that time, at least, there should be, if not the exclusion of costs, a further reduction of costs. And should it be excluded totally, or should it be simply further reduced? We can't really make that analysis there until we can understand the egregiousness of the breach. And we can't understand the egregiousness of the breach until we find out when they started preparing for this hearing, when they appointed instructed counsel. It seems a surprise to me, sir, that you can ring up Mr. Reed QC on the Monday and have him in Dubai for the Thursday. I mean, perhaps he had nothing on. I doubt it, sir. He's a very capable, sought-after counsel.
Okay, but it's a brief fee.
Yes.
Okay.
So, but the real point is, when did this breach start to occur? And it's really, sir, an extension of a clean hands principle, that you shouldn't be asking for costs, or you shouldn't expect your costs to be reduced if you have yourself breached the rules. Now, if it's an inadvertent breach,
No, you've made the point that time.
Thank you,
sir. I understood.
Now, there are, and I should have done that, sir. I referred footnote 4 on page 6 of my submission. I referred to Ford and GKR Construction Centre.
Yes, I saw that.
And that there's really a white book reference to which I was referring to. That's a white book, volume 2015, volume 1, at page 1704. Apologies.
I don't have the 2015 version, so tell me what it says.
It's a copy of the authority provided.
No, sir, I haven't in terms of this application.
Let's put it this way, we've dealt with your first point, we've dealt with your second point.
If you want to just note that reference, white box 1704 for footnote number four. And white book for footnote number 6 is a
reference. Mr. Bowden, we've got our own rule book. You don't need to refer to the white book. You might as well refer to the Australian Code for the Commercial Courts of New South Wales. But if it's covered in our rules, we don't need to look elsewhere.
Those are references to the case.
Right.
Those are the cases discussed.
But I don't have the case.
No, and I'm certainly happy, sir, to forward it through.
Okay.
I knew that this was going to be a brief application, sir, and I didn't want to trouble the court with a...
Well, you're troubling me now.
Okay.
You've got through 2 points. Were there any other points in your application?
Yes, sir. And that's round 3. On reflection, these are, in my submission, sir, pretty weighty issues. And it appears to me that His Honour, Justice Mahari, sir, His Excellency, sorry, Justice Mahari, dealt with this matter on the 6th of November 2014, and by judgment on the 18th of February 2015, sir, it might be appropriate.
Can you add anything to your submissions from paragraph 21 onwards?
No, sir.
Okay.
No, and indeed, sir, I make the point that it's not within the purview of counsel to start telling the registrar how he should conduct matters there, but I do make the respectful suggestions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Hutchison.
Thank you. I'm conscious we've already eaten into a lot of the allocated time, so I can be as brief as I can. From the application notice, which I would comment is on short notice anyway, so we're hearing this application on short notice, but I'm content to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
I think there are 4 points made, but that's certainly how it's set out in the application notice, but I'll deal with them in this order if I may. Firstly, the alleged breach of rules. It seems to me that the submissions that have been made by my opponent largely, if relevant at all, are only to the actual quantum of costs and can only be relevant to that issue. I will make submissions on that if they are pursued in that context subsequently. I would say that on behalf of the claimant, submitted not in breach of any rule, the allegedly egregious conduct my friend refers to relates entirely to the period when my clients made their urgent application in November 2014 to preserve funds in circumstances which were accepted by the judge to have been urgent. In submissions that were, following the order that was made in my client's favour, submissions were invited on costs from the parties, and the claimant submitted their cost submissions, which included at that stage quantum even. So the quantum has actually been out there since December 2014. Now, cost submissions followed. My friend's clients decided not to make any submissions on costs. On 18th of February, the learned judge made his order on cost liability, in which it has been correctly noted that he ordered 50% of cost claimed. There was actually no reasons given that was purely on the basis, or at all on the basis of how the judge saw the issues had fallen in his decision he just ordered. When we have the judgment.
If it helps, I think the points against you fall really into the only substantive point on the question of adjournment.
Sure.
Is on the significance of you filing the wrong form for the detailed assessment process. Mr. Bowden's second point is that if we go ahead with the assessment, I should make a blanket deduction for the conduct of your client in pursuing this cost application, and then look at reasonable and proportionate thereafter. I'm not with Mr. Bowden on his third point, which is why I didn't need him to address me beyond what was in his submission. So I think the substantive point on adjournment is that Mr. Bowden says that whilst he acknowledges in June he did get more information, what he doesn't have is relevant information on the dates on which the time was spent.
I'll address you on those points, sir.
Thank you.
Now, the point about the bill of costs, the claimant submits that its statement with notice of the commencement of detailed assessment and the form that was submitted with that, albeit in name a filed on a statement of cost form, was a compliant bill of costs. It provided sufficient detail by work type, by fee earner, by amount for the court and the other party to be able to deal with whether those amounts were reasonably or proportionately incurred, which is the test. If the court's not with me on that, then what's the consequence? We say, and I think the court has the point, that all material that is required and sufficient to be able to perform the exercise of a detailed assessment is before the court and my learned friend, and it has been since at the latest, 25th of June 2014, when my clients served their reply on the detailed points of costs, which did set out, as the registrar noted, further detail of time spent and tasks undertaken in tabular form and with narrative, which in my submission is sufficient to enable this substantive quantum exercise to be undertaken today. Had my learned friend taken issue with it, he should have done so at the time or soon after that period in June, not 4 months later, having already agreed without reservation to this hearing date going ahead before the registrar. And I say it's simply too late for him to make those points. There's also the issue of proportionality and the overriding objective, which the court and the parties are required to have regard to at all times. And I would say that given that we're here today in relation to a cost assessment, which at its maximum would be just over $57,000, which was represented 0.5% only of the amounts that were in dispute in the underlying application, that even if you're not with me on the form, I'd say it's an argument of form and the substance my friend has, and I think the court has that point, even if the statement was non-compliant technically in accordance with the rules, I say the documents and the information are there. If we consider what the consequences would be of an adjournment, what would be the result of that? The adjournment, I assume, would be for information to be provided in a different form to the court and my learned friend. We say that information is already there, we'd simply be repackaging it, and that would result in further unnecessary delay and costs on both sides. There would be argument over that, but I think in the interest of the overriding objective, we're here now, this can be dealt with, and the case for an adjournment hasn't been properly made by my friend, by my learned friend, and it should have been. These points should have been taken much sooner. That's my point on the form issue.
Thank you.
If I move on to the conduct point, as I understand it in the application, my friend's point is not directed at allegations as to the conduct of my clients in relation to these cost proceedings, but actually the underlying hearing and application in relation to which these costs arise. Principally, again, I say the notice point, and I have sought to address the court on that point, but I don't understand his case to be that he is challenging our conduct in these cost proceedings. Perhaps I'm wrong on that, but that's not what I see from the application notice itself. It's all down to conduct alleged in relation to the underlying application, which I say there is no conduct point there. It was just a matter of commercial litigation as to when applications were filed. The judge dealt with the point, he was addressed on it, and he made an order in consequence upon that. it was dealt with, it's done. This is issues of liability for costs.
I think what's against you is conduct in relation to costs as well. The submission of the wrong form, not responding to requests for information until the last minute, sending through counsel's fee note one day before the hearing. I think those are all against you as well.
So if I might address the point of, okay, the conduct of the, if conduct of the cross proceedings is an issue, my submission to these is that the points of dispute were raised in response to the commencement notice and the statement of cross, bill of costs. In response to that, and substantive points were made by my friend, and he even put forward a sum that he considered his clients would pay for costs. It was a derisory sum, but he did deal with points substantively insofar as he says he felt able. We then did respond substantively within the time period of 14 days, I believe, with a lot of detail of the type we feel, while responding to his point, and that would give him, if he wished, the opportunity, and if he asked, I expect with instructions it would have been consented to, that he could respond again, but he didn't seek any kind of liberty such as that. We then have his point that subsequently he's requested information that wasn't provided. Now, it goes back as far as March, so when this was before the, after the cost order was made, we provided, if I can hand up a document which isn't in, this is just some correspondence which isn't included in my friend's bundle, he has it, I provided it to him this morning. This was the first time that information was requested as to our conduct with the registry, the listing of the first hearing. Now, I don't suggest that the registrar needs to read that now,
No. But
that was the first request for information that was met. The two requests for information that are complained of now as having not been responded to, I think one on the 20th of September and one on the 12th of October, these were requests made in correspondence by my opponent at a time when his clients were in breach of an order of this court for payment on account of costs. They were in breach for 4 weeks and only then, last week, I think, paid the interim payment into court. Once that was done, we provided, I accept it was yesterday, the copies of the disbursements invoice for SAR. It comprised counsel's fee note, which is simple and, you know, it's a brief fee, there's not much analysis that can go into that. You know, we can't do better than that. And core fee invoices issued by this court, those comprise the disbursements. I say there's no prejudice suffered there. And all of the other information that may have been requested that hasn't been provided, we say is irrelevant to the issues that go to assessment of costs. They can only go to my learned friend's bad point, I say, on breach of the rules in relation to liability for costs, which have already been dealt with by the judge in his costs order. So I say, in summary, that we are not in breach of the rules. Our conduct has been perfectly fine and in accordance with the rules in providing information. Again, if he felt he was deficient in anything, which we say is not the case, he should have asked much earlier, and by applying very late in the day to adjourn this hearing, we say should not be permitted to derail cost proceedings, which we say are not complicated and can be reasonably proportionately dealt with today. Those are my submissions on the two points there, unless the registrar wishes me to address him on any of the other points my friend has made.
Thank you. Thank you. We're here in the in relation to an application issued on the 19th of October 2015. An application of the, said to be the defendant, in case CFI 36 of 2014, an application for the hearing today to be adjourned with an award of costs to the respondent, and for the hearing itself to be transferred to a justice of the DIFC courts. The application lists three supporting elements. The first and perhaps most persuasive is that the procedure for a detailed cost assessment has not been properly followed, not least because the requirement for a bill of cost to be filed has not been complied with, and instead a statement of cost was submitted. It's acknowledged that to some extent the deficiencies of the statement of cost were remedied by way of the claimant's reply submissions issued on 25th of June 2015, in which further details of the time spent were set out. The point made by the applicant is that even with those, there is not sufficient detail in order for his client to fully understand the nature of the costs being claimed, not least because the dates on which the time was spent are not clear to him. The point that's been made in response is that whilst it isn't accepted that there is a deficiency between a statement of cost and a bill of cost, if there were to be a deficiency, the missing information is not sufficient to detract from the overriding objectives of the court as set out in their rules. I think on balance that view is correct. Whilst we must look carefully at adherence to the rules for the purposes of the assessment of quantum, and Mr. Bowden has made strong arguments in that regard, with which I find favour for the time being. We must also accept that technical breach should not be allowed, particularly at a late stage, to delay the enforcement of orders of this court. So on balance, I reject the application for an adjournment. The second point made in the application, to my mind, is one of quantum and will be dealt with in the detailed cost hearing, and I find no grounds to uphold the third point of the application. That said, there is an important matter that must be addressed before we proceed with any detailed cost assessment, and that is the requirement for the receiving party to confirm to the court that, and I quote from Practice Direction 5 of 2014, which was brought to my attention again by Mr. Bowden, whose submissions on the point are gratefully received, that any cost summary or bill of costs must include a statement signed by a registered practitioner that the bill accurately reflects the amounts which the client is liable to pay, and that there are no arrangements in place which will reduce the amount due and payable by the client, depending dependent on the outcome of the cost assessment. So whilst I reject the application, I'm only willing to proceed with a detailed cost assessment on the basis that counsel for the receiving party confirms that situation to the court.
If I'm obliged, I'm able to confirm that expressly to the court that that statement is correct and accurate and true in relation to the cross claims. I was the individual at Time Care who signed the statement of truth on the bill of cross when submitted, and I confirm that now.
Thank you. Mr. Bowman?
I don't know if he's an officer of the court, he's seen what he's seen, but I'm not in a position to question him in any way. Okay, that's important.
Thank you. So we have the costs of the application to consider, or should we do that as part of a decision on the overall costs of the costs process?
I'm happy for it to be reserved until that point, so my preference is to get on with it.
Okay, let's do that. So, Mr. Hutchison.
I'm obliged. Now, much of the summary information the court is aware of already, having read the documents, I'm grateful for that. So, if we look at then what is it that's claimed? As I mentioned at the beginning, the claim the receiving party seeks costs of $57,498.60, which represents 50% of its full claim for costs of $114,000.
There's a $300 discrepancy somewhere in here, so the numbers you're giving me are subject to that, aren't they?
Yes, there is an adjustment made in the reply submission, which adjusts a small correction by a change of partner rate to consultant rate for one of the entries. But yes, a small discrepancy, the figures can be finalised at the end. But it's five. The accurate figure claim is 57498.60, representing 50% of 114.997.20. And that 50% being, as per the order of His Excellency Al Mahiri, 18th February 2015, is the maximum amount that my client is entitled to recover subject to assessment if not agreed.
Understood. Now, half of that is in court, is it?
Half of the 50% is now in court.
Thank you.
Yes. Now, that, in terms of proportionality of costs, which is one of the tests in the court.
Can I interrupt you? Just to clear off the basics, the rates that are being sought, are they within the indicative hourly rates issued by the court?
Aside from one of the rates, so yes, there were indicative rates in force at the time of the hearing pursuant to which the costs were incurred.
Yeah.
And then in 2015 there have been some revised rates that were very recent. We have analysed both sets, depending on which one the court would use as a guide, and save for the rates of Mr. Paul Hughes and senior associate of Clive & Co, who was 5 years PQE at the time, all of the other rates are within the guidelines, and Mr. Hughes comes in slightly above. And I believe that the difference when you come down to the numbers is about $900
overall.
Overall. So it's marginalised.
All right. Thank you. So proportionality.
My point on proportionality is that, it is one of the tests that the court is asked to bear in mind under Part 38 when it's considering an assessment. The application that my clients made in November was an application to preserve funds of $11.5 million, which was being paid by the defendants, which was ordered to be paid by the defendants in the Al-Qarafi, Banks House, and Banks House and Alpha litigation, to which my friend's clients are the claimants in that action. So $11.5 million, an urgent interim application was brought, we say reasonably and proportionately and necessarily. The cost being claimed now, if we talk in percentage terms for a proportionality figure, is 0.5% only of the total amount that was sought to be preserved, the relief that was sought and obtained in those proceedings. The map, if we look at our 100% cost figure, that is only 1% of the total amount that was being preserved in the underlying application. So if we were looking purely in numerical terms, that, I say, is a clear indication of the proportionality of the costs. I'm aware, as the court will be, that proportionality is not the only...
No, but your client's interest in the case wouldn't be to that level, would it?
So, yes.
Is half a percent of your client's economic interest in the case?
Well, our client's economic interest in that case, we say, is more than 50% of the monies that were sought and were indeed ordered to be paid into court, the 11.5 million. At the time of the application, our client's interest in those monies, we say, was just over $10 million. Since intervening events, a recent judgment of the court on the 7th of October, our client's position is that it's entitled to more than the sum that was entitled to at that time because of further damages. But in terms of percentages, yes, we represented nearly the entire amount, we say, of the 11.5 million.
Thank you.
So, the test, as I've said, under Rule 38, particularly RDC 38.18, is one that costs were reasonably incurred, proportionate where they were incurred, and even though they may be proportionate, that's just an indication for the court. So, all things considered as well, all the circumstances of the case, the court has the ability and is encouraged to look at. Now, what I'm going to do here today is talk about the general principles, I don't want to take the court through things that it's fully familiar with, rather than, as my case as the receiving party, take you through all of our numbers which are in the actual bill.
Well, look, having read it all, it may be, given that the position is that where there's doubt, it falls against you. Perhaps it go on for as long as you'd like, but you may just want to hear Mr. Bowden's objections and then deal with those.
Sure. If I may make 2 points before I allow my friend to do so. So I've made the point about proportionality. In terms of complexity, my friend said in his application earlier that this was a straightforward...
No, I've read the papers.
...application. We say it was a complex application. In terms of the scope of work and those individuals, how it was resourced and geared, we say it was entirely in line with a modern commercial law firm's dealing with a substantial piece of commercial litigation in terms of division of work between partners, consultants, associates and trainees, and the disbursements of the instruction of a junior QC, very junior QC at the time, was indeed entirely appropriate and proportionate. I would like to make, and whether I do this now, reply points in relation to comparisons with the...
I saw that.
If Sir has
Thank
points,
you.
Then I'll... I'm happy to hand over to my friend and then make any points in response. I'll go by you.
Thank you. Mr. Bowden.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I might just observe, sir, that probably a bit late now, I accept that I should have raised it before, but I might have liked to have been heard in reply on the earlier application, sir, but it was incumbent upon me to raise it, and I didn't. So we'll move on. Just on, shall we deal with the proportionality point first? With respect to it, it's just not that relevant, because we're making here, sir, an application to, but even on silent,
it vibrates.
There's simply an application to distract some funds, and so the proportionality principle, it's not like my learned friend has just obtained judgment for 10.1 million. I can tell you, sir, that it's our position that his client's not entitled England. It cancelled, there were two agreements, it cancelled the first one, and it obtained the second one by economic duress, amongst other things, breach of a myriad of duties, misrepresentation.
Might be a matter for another judge, I think.
Yes, exactly, sir. But at the time,
there was felt to be a risk of losing 10 million. And I understand your point, which is the rules provide that it doesn't matter what the relative costs are compared to the amount in issue. Yeah.
And in relation to the concerns that the claimant had at the time, I've got a concession on that, sir, and because I've said that there was. It's been my position. I wasn't employed then, and so it's fine for me to come and criticise in hindsight. But I've taken the position in 036, number 3 application, that there was a basis to make the application. I'm not happy the way it was made, but clause 31.1 of the RLFA, I've got a copy here if you want to wish to
prove it.
Of the litigation funding agreement.
Oh, okay.
It provided. That funds be paid into KBA, any funds would come be paid into KBH's trust account and be held on trust. Mm. Of course, sir, that'd be disengaged. There was an obligation upon our firm, right, to secure those funds. And it was an obligation that they never said that they were intending to shirk. Mm. But the negotiations, I've made. I think our firm should have acted with more alacrity. Okay. Mm. So, and therefore, sir, that's why I'm not attacking the 50% that the judge dealt with at the time, because he dealt with the relative success of the parties at the time. He said, well, he had some cause for concerns. People weren't, emails weren't being responded to quickly enough, etc., etc. But there's nothing to say. I mean, I am interposing because I didn't express these exact words, but then no one said that they were going to take off with the money. The money wasn't indeed, sir. The money didn't arrive and for nearly another month. Right? It didn't actually get paid until the very beginning of December. So, it was one of those. So on that basis, and so when it came to court, it was settled actually by consent very, very quickly. I think if our teams who hadn't gone on to make some not very bright submissions on the issue of jurisdiction, etc., which we dealt with in the later submissions here and really formed most of the basis for the 18th of February judgment. Mm-hmm. Quite possibly there would be no cost at all. So that's why we didn't appeal the order. In essence, pretty hard to criticise His Excellency for the decision that he came to. Something had to be done with money, and the timing was right. Okay. So I've dealt with proportionality, sir. I've dealt with, in essence, the 50%. But what is on did not deal with, sir, is this, well, my learned friend is right regarding the notice period, so the 3 days. It's pretty clear, sir, that Rule 23.24, I think it is, provides for 3 clear days. I don't understand my learned friend to seriously argue, although it was only time, that's not clearly a breach of the rules. His Honour did deal with the point then, but of course, I think he was, with respect, His Excellency was given a bit of a fait accompli. Mm. I mean, there he was. It was Thursday afternoon, and it became quite apparent to him that the notice period hadn't been complied with. But at the same time, there was a need to do something about money if it should be forthcoming. Mm-hmm. Of course, just on the forthcomingness of the money, sir, needs to be remembered that Altamini and co representing the unsuccessful defendants had attended the hearing but been excluded, but then went on to make a stay application. So there was a lot of water to go under the bridge before any checks were written out. and that must have been quite apparent too. But His Honour most suitably dealt with that point, but what he did not deal with is this point of what was the effect and what was the effect on costs of the lack of notice period. And I've already pointed to, and this really does come down to conduct. I've already pointed to the first significant consequence of that, and that is that the party had 1/3 less time to prepare, and it was really worse than that.
I don't want to cross you, but looking at it here, it would appear as if it was the direction of the judge that the matter be heard on 6th of November. If that's the case, then the judge is absolutely entitled to determine directions for a matter as he sees fit. So the point goes away about clear days and the like, doesn't it?
It does,
yeah. Because the judge can determine what he thinks is best and right and reasonable in the circumstances. So if it was the judge, as is suggested in His Excellency's order, that he directed that the hearing be on the 6th of November, then in a sense we can cut through the point about the rules.
Thank you for reminding me. I didn't understand from such contemporary correspondences of the vaccines that actually was the way that the matter went down. I haven't brought with me, I don't think, that initial email dated the 3rd of November. From Mrs. Clyde and Co., which suggested then that a hearing date would be available on the 6th of November, and that the exact time would be provided by the registrar. So whilst I accept that the order says that, sir,
that's fine now.
Yes. And if you wish to do the submissions on that,
do you see here it says upon the direction of Justice O'Mara on the hearing will be on the 6th. I'm assuming that's an email from the registry. Could you look in the system for me, see what you can pull up about this application on the 3rd part 8 being heard on the 6th grade? Do you want the whole thing? Or just want to... Alright, so let's have a look at that and then we can come back to it.
I don't have that point, sir. There was an email, and I am going by. I haven't got my correspondence file for the 0.
It's okay. We'll look it up now.
And I have that email too, which suggested we filed this, and there's a date available on Thursday. The registry didn't tell you exactly when. That's my recollection.
Okay.
My correspondence.
So
whilst the order may reflect something, and I'm not sure that my learned friends didn't draft the order either. So might be a contract referee.
As long as they didn't sign it.
Sorry.
As long as they didn't sign it.
It might be a contract referee to that soon. But regardless, it's a very serious responsibility that one party has to the other party to make sure that they have proper time to here. And if I'm
let's move on, because if that's what the judge decided,
on that point, sir, it brought in another very serious responsibility, sir, and that is, sir, the fact that if it was not on notice, on 3 days' notice, sir, it was then an application without notice or without proper notice.
Look, that's not a serious point. I read it. It was a point, but not one I'd expect a counsel of your experience to make to me. Let's deal with the issue of whether it was a court direction, and I think then it will go away. Have you got... Do you want to move beyond the issue of the 3 days for now? We can come back to it.
Okay. just point to paragraph 20 of my written application to, or the memorandum. I just wanted to raise this point because this is the proposition of law as to the further reduction. And I think that's an important one too.
This is point 20.
Make reference to North Star.
Which
and paragraph 20 of the memorandum dated 18 October, page 6.
Yeah, okay, this is your application.
This is my last point before we do move on to. It might be added that the fact that the learned judge in the decision dated 18 February made a cost reduction of 50% cannot be set off against the issues raised in this substantive defence. In other words, it's no defence for the claimant to say my costs were reasonably incurred because the judge made a reduction.
Your point. I'm looking at number paragraph 20, page 6 of the of the attachment to your application for adjournment. Could you take me to the? What's your point again? Am I looking at the right place?
Yes.
Okay.
Because the 50% reduction which the judge made.
Yeah.
Okay. He made it based on his assessment of the merits of the case and the success of the parties at trial. He did not deal with this point, further conduct point, about notice and the effects of that. And it did have an effect. Clearly, less time to prepare. I say, sir, I realise your honour's not attracted to the point, but I say, sir, that because we dropped below the 3 days notice, a whole lot of additional disclosure obligations came onto the claimant. And they should really have been saying, well, actually, sir, there's a bit of a question mark about us being able to get any of this money that we sent to Australia, and that should have been raised. Obviously, they'll play hotly dispute that now, and they would then, but I do make that point. It has a knock-on effect. And the point is, too, that if the judge has not dealt with the issue, and I've made the reference there, I should have made the reference under footnote 6 on that page, where I said North Star, to the discussion of the white book at page 1709, sir, where it says, sir, if the judge makes no audited costs, there's no problem, but if the judge orders a reduction of, say, 20% or more, without more, what would be the natural construction of that order? My view is the natural construction of such an order, unless the contrary is expressly stated, is that the party guilty of, and it says their dishonesty, and I'm saying that this is not that category, but it is a serious breach of the rules, should not be entitled to say in the assessment, my costs incurred seeking to make a dishonest case can be taken as reasonably incurred because the judge has made a reduction. Okay? If the dishonest party was entitled to succeed in such an argument,
look, I'm with you. You don't need to spend any more time on that. I'm with you entirely. Right. The judge has said, I have considered all matters. I think that only 50% of the cost should be recoverable. Mm. And of the 50%, it must be reasonable and proportionate. That's why it comes to us today. So don't think there's an assumption that because it's 50% that makes them reasonable or proportionate. It doesn't. That's why we're going to have a look at them today. So it's a point that's received.
Yes. And I don't want to re-argue a point I lost, sir, but it's made it tough for us all the way. Okay. And that is certainly the point that Your Honour was indicating. Now, the statement of costs, well, apart from the arguments as to form, which we say aren't trivial arguments at all, I would like to say, sir, in fact I do make the submission, that it's straight out non-compliance with 40.5, brackets 2, so therefore there's an immediate jurisdictional bar that if you can't put in a bill of costs, and you put in something else, and you say, well, when you then get down to here and you say, well, it's just a matter of the label on top, so when clearly it's not. And a bill of costs, as the detailed references in the White Talk suit 47, practice direction 47.
This isn't a point for now. This is a point that you'll make, I suspect, when we talk about costs of this assessment process.
Yes.
Because you're going to say it hasn't been done properly, and therefore the costs of the process, if they find themselves against your client, should be reduced accordingly. What we're looking at the moment, though, before we come on to that, is the costs of the application, the 50%. That's what we need to focus on now. Then we'll come on to the costs of the detailed assessment process, including the cost of your application.
Well, my point, I hope, cuts both ways.
Sure.
Of course, it relates to if I'm unsuccessful or not completely successful in this application. So, it depends what success is. Mm-hmm. Because my principal point here is I contend that we should go for a further reduction of 50% and then look at those allocations and say they're not reasonable and order a percentage of those and broad brush, maybe we're looking at 25% of what's found to be reasonable. So, but my primary point, sir, and I recognise that I may not succeed on it, but my primary point is that 40.5 is a jurisdictional requirement, and I think it's, even if not admitted, it's pretty clear that it hasn't been complied with, and so that should stop the process right there.
Well, we've dealt with your application. Let me move you on to the question of the statement of costs as bolstered by the June submission. What you need to persuade me of is that there are elements of it, or all of it, if you wish, which is not reasonable and not proportionate.
I take you to page 44 of my learned friend's book, the main bundle.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then if we go to paragraph 11, we could perhaps come back to page 43 and paragraph 7.
This was your suggestion of $6,000.
That's right, sir. Mm-hmm. We've got something between a half and a quarter day. And whether it's for a dollar or $1 million, doesn't really matter. Mm-hmm. There's a contractual provision which you rely on, it says that this money shall be secured. They're coming along, they're saying, there's a sum of money too. It needs to be secured. Unusual situations have arisen that the people who would otherwise have had the obligation to secure it have been relieved of their instructions. Another firm has come in, they're not party to the agreement which required that the money be secured. They haven't said they won't. They've made murmurings, they've been to the bank and they haven't managed to set up an escrow account. We had correspondence with them last on the Friday, the 30th.
You'll better use your time looking at the amount that's claimed and persuading me which elements of it are not reasonable and proportionate than painting the broad picture, because I've got that. You've done a good job in painting the broad picture. I've got it.
Very well. That is how I came to paragraph 11 on page 44.
Yeah.
Preparation. Pretty senior. If you needed a senior person at all, which flying the QC from nothing good for specs was complete overkill. My learned friend is a highly capable advocate. He did put together the application rather well. His witness statement was of an extraordinary length, but my learned friend's a capable advocate. They've got Mr. Emerson, he's Mr. Disputes of the Middle East. Clyde and Co. Clyde and Co. Sir were complete with wonderful advocates. Why, sir, they needed to fly an admittedly capable, but as my learned friend points out, junior QC halfway around the world for this, it is, I suspect, largely a matter of the choice of its client. I've raised other.
But won't they say, we flew a junior QC up because there was $10 million at stake? I mean, wasn't the point that if if they couldn't secure that fund, they potentially might lose it? Or would you say that there wasn't an urgency and that the money was going nowhere?
Well, that goes back to the 50%, I think the judges decided that matter. But did they need a QC to fly a QC from London to establish that point? And I think the answer is resoundingly no. Look at the way that the hearing unfolded. Judge came in, he said, well, what do you say? I said, look, I'll give you a chance to sort this out. Mm-hmm. I think I understand. Matters went close, wasn't resolved. Judge came in and said, look, it's going to go to the court. Everyone said, fine. There's just no big points of law to argue these. There's more in this hearing than there were in that.
Mm. Okay.
The next person. Hearing time, 3 hours. And I am taking the very generous higher estimates here. So I think in my estimates, as set out in paragraph 11, so I'm again in deference to the wonderful skill of the client co-advocates who saying that they deserve the top rate. But look at realistically, so what actually ought to be expended on something like this.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the responsibility which all parties have, so is to keep costs proportionate and not run up 119,000 odd dollar bills for a hearing that lasts between a quarter and a half of a day. Supervision, submissions, really, very, very little. If one looks at the skeleton argument put together, it's and submitted in the case, there's not that much to it with respect. I'm not sure if Your Honour has the skeleton argument submitted by my learned friends in the hearing, sir.
No.
But it ran to 20 odd pages of double spaced type, sir. It didn't deal with any particularly massive legal issues. And that there, sir. So I'm just struggling to put my hand over in the funnel, so I may have taken it out of it during the hearing.
It's okay.
But my point is that, sir. It's just, the skeleton argument deserved maybe six, perhaps I'm being a bit light there, sir, 10 hours, okay? A bit of high level supervision, a few hours of miscellaneous hearing. I say, sir, 18, 20 hours. If one was to apply 50% to that, it halves it. If, as I contend, for sir, there is actually further reduction from that. But look, sir, if we walk out of this hearing, sir, we're in an award of cost between 6,000 and 8,000, sir, well, we wouldn't be here today.
You'd have done a good job.
Well, but of course, sir, if the parties have emerged from the 6th of November hearing with that, it would have been. I should probably have added to a few hours for the later submissions, etc. We made some not that bright ones, but perhaps, we're looking at a total allocation of around 20 hours. I've upped it from 18. Mm-hmm. When we come to the documents which have been provided, there was, with respect, no need to reply, because the submission I put in on the 4th of June was completely unaltered by the submission provided on the 25th of June. Indeed, how one can sort of morph, if one likes, a bill of costs into a submission is beyond me. But it was nevertheless done here, sir. But again, the slightly more detail provided doesn't provide any basis whatsoever for analysis of the reasonableness of those time allocations. We don't know, sir, was Mr. Hutchison and Mr. Emerson and Mr. Hughes all working on the same issue at the time? Is it something that counsel should not have been attempting within we just don't know, Sue. The attendance is on the opponents, 10.5 hours. Well, our timesheets don't reflect that, Sue. The correspondence doesn't reflect that. I don't understand there was any face-to-face meetings. There was a few. Perhaps my learned friend could tell me if there was in fact a face-to-face meeting. I know that there was one at KPH. I believe that Pride & Co. went to attend it and they were asked to meet by KPH. Perhaps my learned friend could confirm that. That's from my understanding of the history of the fire. But,
so I can't recall without checking the file whether meetings may have been open or without prejudice, so I can't confirm either way, I'm afraid. I can say that there were.
This is attendance on, would you say opponents or others?
Opponents.
See, I've got, look here, it's got 5.3 hours email correspondence and telephone comms. Alec Emerson, email correspondence and telephone comms. Paul Hughes reviewing correspondence with, from representatives of the Al Karafis. So they're not claiming for any meetings, are they?
Well, does that fall within documents, sir? Because is that not the creation of
well, wherever it sits, you're saying well, they weren't having any meetings, and you're quite right.
Yeah. I don't understand.
You're quite right.
If, as I thought it should, I mean, that, and indeed, sir, that's the problem with providing a statement of costs when a bill of costs is required. A bill of costs would have these matters set out properly in itemised schedules, and one would be able to understand them. And we just simply haven't got these here. And so, if my submissions on these matters are inadequate, sir, I retort that it is the material before me which brings that situation to bear. I've made the point, sir, 61.5 hours for the completion of these documents, sir. It's putting together documents does take a long time. I know that, sir, because it's all I seem to do, but 61.5 hours is enormous for something. And so if sir, as I suspect, you and your honours intending a broad brush approach, I simply say that it seems excessive in view of the relatively small scope of legalities of the matter. And indeed, sir, the hearing bundle, and this is the same sort of bundle, sir, approximately as we've got today. It's a single bound volume, and there's not a great deal of original material in it. The skeleton argument only arrived on the morning of the trial, so skeleton argument arrived mid morning on the 6th, sir. So it was very late. Again, that's the 3-day rule being breached there.
Mm-hmm.
Other than the relatively sort of discursive skeleton argument, didn't go in for any analysis of anything. My recollection is that the skeleton argument did not cover any particular points of law, didn't cite cases to any great length, so it's a pretty broad brush. There was admittedly a statement from Mr. Hutchison, which I think was 103 pages and perhaps exceeded the bounds of what's reasonable in a witness statement for something of this nature. But it again, sir, was a pretty much a narrative document, annexing a great deal of correspondence and others. And it's the kind of thing that could be easily put together by a capable secretary, of which I know led to Clyde and Craig has a legion of those as well, sir. Coming to the end of it, we dealt with the 40,000, sir. The disbursement, which has been belatedly explained, I can't say any more about it, sir. Travel and waiting, well, I've had the please assume if a team of bonding officers have applied in Cohen, I know that they are about a 5 minute walk from this building soon.
You must walk very quickly.
A lot of hard
effort. Without waiting for the lift.
Even somebody of my age and stage can hobble down here. ten on them. So, I can't take it too much further. I think I've covered it in the moment.
Thank you.
So what we have in this cost assessment is, if we start at page 38 of the bundle, statement of costs, bill of costs, nomenclature aside,
yeah,
these are the specific amounts claimed by Vanin for each particular work type on the matter,
yes,
by reference to name, hours, minutes, rate, and total for each.
Yeah.
Those were supplemented in my client's reply submissions on the points of dispute,
yeah,
and elucidated in further detail, particularly from page 48 of the bundle, paragraph 3, further detail on costs claimed. There's some narrative paragraphs from 3.1 to 3.6, and then we go on to 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, mm-hmm, looking in detail at each of those work types and time records from that statement. What I haven't heard from my friend, other than a couple of references to dispersants and some points on breach of rules, which I can address you on separately, is specific challenges to the cost items claimed and elaborated on in the reply. If we look at, ignore the general points up to 3.6, before we start there, tendencies on that, nothing at all is said about those before you now, in terms of the way I understand the cost assessment to work would be, for example, Mr. Emerson there, 5.3 hours, this total cost, there's the work that was done in summary basis. There's nothing that's been said that I've heard that supports the contention that any of that is not reasonable or proportionate. And I think that pervades, if you turn the pages going on and on, we talked about tendencies on payments, some very broad brush submissions on, well, let's just cut it all in half by 25%. I say no. We haven't heard anything that should persuade the court.
I know, but look, I've probably done more of these than the two of you have. So we're not on unfamiliar territory. I'm fairly certain if we tasked with Bowden with going through every list, he would flag that Alec Emerson doing visa applications is not a sensible use of his time. I'm sure you would. But I've got a good sense of it because I'm assisted by the June submission to understand, and I've read the file, so I've got a good sense of the urgency and complexity. I take the proportionality point, although I'm more with Mr. Bowden on that, that the actual amount is only a factor to be taken account of. So I think as a court, what we have to look at is not what was charged between a law firm and their client. That's something between the law firm and their client. But what's it fair for the other side to pick up? What's reasonable and proportionate for the other side to contribute to those costs? And I think there was one specific point, which is counsel wasn't needed because the talent within client care was such that they could have done it. And that's a point I'd like you to talk about. And then more generally, the point seems to me to be that too much time, or that whilst no one's doubting that the time was spent, it's not reasonable and proportionate for the other side to pick up all of the time that was spent between the three fee earners. And you may not need to talk for too long about that, but do talk to me about choice of counsel, would you? Do you have registered practitioners? Do you apply to
Co has part one registration for all of its registered practitioners and only a very limited number of part two registered practitioners. I am not a part two practitioner, but I'm permitted to appear before the registrar today under the rules anyway as part one. And therefore, the ability for Clyde & Co lawyers to represent clients in full hearings before a judge is very limited, and it is the general commercial practice of many law firms, but particularly Clyde & Co, to prefer the instruction of external counsel. The nature of this court being common law and largely procedurally based on, you know, familiar principles from the English courts is to instruct counsel from England. On the proportionality basis, it was felt entirely reasonable and appropriate and commercially sensible with the amount at stake and the complexity of an interim, essentially, you know, quasi-freezing order on urgent notice with skeletal arguments, multiple parties, complicated issues of a tripartite agreement with a perhaps unrelated party bank being ordered to being subject to the order. We believed, and our clients believed, necessitated the instruction of counsel. We chose a, we instructed a junior QC, so very junior, negotiated a good brief fee, and we consider that his experience of that counsel in this court already, and his familiarity with the rules, in fact saved costs of using someone else, perhaps a Clyde & Co lawyer or another less familiar counsel, commensurate with the issues overall and the costs. I think if you really drill into it, you'd see the £17,500 plus expenses for counsel on a business class ticket, not first class.
Are you sure about that? Because it's a very, very high business class fare.
I believe it's about £4,000.
Yeah, so it'd be 26,000 dirhams for business.
Which Clyde & Co does not permit any counsel that instructs to fly first class. We won't instruct counsel, we insist on that.
Thank you.
It's not fair at all on clients. So we believe that the instruction of counsel entirely is proportionate. If you compare to what my other friend talked about, representation in court, during that hearing, I was here that day, I don't think anyone else was in the room, but we had one advocate, we had on this side for Panther Ashanti two, both of whom made submissions at the hearing, with, I think they had five people in court all told on their actual benches, more so than we had on the claimant's side. So to hear arguments about overriding it in terms of resourcing, I take issue with that on the basis that they resourced it more heavily, and that's borne out by their own statement of cost filed for that hearing, which records, I think, almost double the number of hours spent by Clyde & Co. It's about 114 hours all told,
yeah,
compared to Clyde & Co 61. I haven't done the full initial total hours. Mr. Bowman, I've greatly accepted 61, but I think in terms of criticism of resources, so that's counsel, and I would say that £17,500 for what was more than a half-day hearing, it was a hugely complex issue, with things being served and filed, authorities right up to the wire, and including drafting a skeleton argument, which Clyde & Co had review input in, strategy input with the client, but the drafting work was principally done by counsel, and Clyde & Co assisting on that. We had three principal fee earners, myself, Alec Emerson, and Paul Hughes, working on the matter, and we divided tasks between us, and I think that's borne out in the schedule of costs. But commercial law firms do not work, and clients do not pay duplication of effort. And the amounts that have been claimed here, as I can confirm to the court, are amounts no more than have been billed to our client for that work.
No, I understand that, but look, I think let's not polarise it. You've got on page 52. Yourself, internal correspondence discussing strategy and case management. Alec Emerson, internal correspondence discussing strategy and case management. Paul Hughes, internal correspondence discussing strategy and case management. Clearly there's overlap.
So, in terms of it's not uncommon at all for parties within a team, within a law firm who are working on a matter to discuss issues of strategy, to discuss instructions, to discuss the vision of work and action points. That doesn't suggest that every single discussion involved all three people. Myself as the partner supervises the matter. Alec Emerson is a consultant who provides input, strategic analysis, expertise from all his years of experience.
As well as applying for visas.
That, on the basis of the visa application, was because of the timing, it was over a weekend, and the only person who had the ability at that point in time...
We've done this before. There is naturally going to be the need for people to sit naturally the need for many eyes on documents and an urgent matter. I understand that. But to what extent that carries across is what we've got to work out. So your submission on council is that council save money?
In terms of the level of council that was commensurate with the issues and complexity, we consider it was proportionate to instructor QC, junior QC, at a good commercial rate, and that had, if it was suggested, we instructed, we used a filing code where those who are part two, mm-hmm. our partners, I think say one or two people, who weren't involved in the matter, would have had to read in, other than Mr. Emerson, whose rate is 3,000 per hour, would have had to spend at least as much time as council, maybe we exclude travel time, but that's all wrapped up in the briefing anyway. So we say the instruction of council overall would have actually saved costs and made the whole hearing more efficient. Because
and was there no local council here in Dubai you could have used?
Our client, on the basis of consultation with the filing code, preferred the instruction of counsel from England because of his expertise in this court and his level of experience. It is free to any party to choose whichever counsel it wishes to choose to represent it, and there isn't anyone we would say who is suitable externally from within Dubai, given that there are no barristers' chambers.
Out of Temple.
I stand corrected. We would not consider that it was appropriate to instruct anyone at that time. At those chambers. So those are my submissions on council. And I addressed the court in a roundabout way on gearing and how filing code structure matters. I'm sure you're familiar with the way a commercial law works.
I am. And one thing that one would normally expect to see is, and we'll come a little bit onto the sort of pyramid, which is a bit off on this one, but you don't push work down beyond Mr. Hughes, who is at the time is 5 years. So you haven't got teams underneath supporting junior assistants and trainees and paralegals supporting. What was the reason for that?
At the time on this case, whilst we had been instructed for a couple of weeks or a number of weeks prior to, in terms of acting for valid, mm-hmm. the instructions to deal with this application, to prepare an application, but my learned friend's quite agitated by the date on which council was instructed, in which we were instructed to proceed with an application, was not before 31st of October. We decided at that point an application was urgent. The people who had been dealing on the matter to that point were myself, Mr. Emerson, and Mr. Hughes, in advising that. We were the people who knew the documents, knew the issues that had arisen. Therefore, we were the team who have decided in a very short period of time to put the application together with council, and it didn't involve at that point any delegation to juniors other than in relation to sort of minor tasks of bundling. As Mr. Bowden said, we use secretaries for, and we have skilled legal secretaries who do a lot of bundling and administrative work who aren't even claimed for, so that's mm-hmm. cost savings to them, that being done by administrative non fee earning staff rather than a junior or a trainee. We're able to do that.
So my last question to you is, I've totted up the numbers, not with any great specificity, but it looks to me as if roughly Mr. Emerson's coming in at about 36 hours, yourself at about 29 hours, and Mr. Hughes at about 61 hours overall. I say that may be wrong because I've just totted them up from the...
Could you give me the breakdown again?
I've got it roughly, Mr. Emerson about 36 hours, yourself mm-hmm. about 29 hours. No. The other way, I'm ever so sorry. Yourself at 36 hours, Mr. Emerson at 29 hours, and Mr. Hughes at 61 hours.
I've actually been, my assistant has kindly provided
Thank
me
you.
With a document. The hours we have from taken directly, the split is this: Alec Emerson 23.6, myself 40.9, and Mr. Hughes 51.4. We have, which extrapolated out across with the charge rates and times to give individual figure items in dollars, if it would help the court.
No. So that's the split, is it, in terms of hours?
That's the split in terms of hours. We've then applied our actual rates, and then I've got a table which has the DIFC, applying the DIFC rates as well. I have the total US dollar figures for each component part, if that would assist the court.
Have you got it there?
I do. Is this a copy? So I have a spare copy. I'll give it to the court. You've got one more.
This is based on the 2014 rates as they applied.
Yeah, at the time.
So we have on the left hand, I'll just hand it to my friend.
Oh, I see.
So we have here, on the left hand side, there's this dark bar down the middle of the page. On the left hand side is Clyden Kerry's actual fees broken down in the statement, and on the right is if you were applying the DIFC indicative rates, and the numbers in grey are dollar figures, and then to the right of each column is the dirham figure, just for reference.
Yeah.
And you'll see at the bottom on the left, the 57 in the box highlighted, bordered 57,419.60, which is the cost claimed.
Yeah.
So you'll see that the majority of the time was incurred by Mr. Hughes. If we're talking on a pyramid basis, there is a pyramid. I accept that it's maybe a slightly narrow pyramid to what the court might expect to see, but nonetheless it is a pyramid. Mr. Emerson, albeit a consultant, was prior to that a very senior equity partner and Clyden Kerry, a very experienced litigator, so the case has been managed by myself principally as the partner of the firm, and Mr. Emerson contributing as and when necessary due to his experience and knowledge of the matter and the issues and this court, having appeared himself previously. If I might make one comment while we're looking at the pure numbers, is that my friend said, I believe he submitted, that a broad brush, 50% had already been cut, if you like, as a maximum by the judge, and that a 25% reduction, again, would be possibly appropriate. I think that's far too generalised and sweeping statement to apply. This is a detailed cost assessment, and it should be done on a an item basis, and so far as they're set out that way.
It's a bit rich.
Well, on the basis, but to the extent they're itemised, it would apply.
Mr. Barron, do you want to take a phone call?
No, sir, I am looking at two practitioners on my pension, because I'm quite sure that I know Sibling. One on point, isn't Mr. Emerson
one?
He is. Yeah, he is, yeah.
I've already addressed the court on Mr. Emerson's rate, and
the sense was, if Mr. Emerson had done it himself, it would have cost more than having counsel. That was the submission.
Well, he would keep the time he spent in court.
Mr. Emerson, there isn't actually any time charged for Mr. Emerson in court, I think, if I'm right. That's the correction that was made there. If you see on attendances at hearing, page 39,
mm-hmm.
it lists Mr. Emerson and Mr. Emerson's attendance at hearing, travel and waiting time.
Yeah.
In the reply submissions we received on the 25th of June, we actually made a correction to that statement, and this gives rise to the slight discrepancy in figures, in that it was actually myself who attended the hearing, not mm-hmm. Mr. Emerson, and
yes.
That the adjustment in rate reduced the...
Exactly.
That's why Mr. Emerson didn't actually appear. Well, he was here, I think, in an observational capacity, but wasn't charged for. I think he was interested in...
That's why the numbers I added up were...
Yeah.
Off. I see. Now, this is correct, then.
This is our... my learned friend hadn't seen it before now, but this is purely us extrapolating out the figures, the correct figures...
Thank you.
...based on that adjustment.
Yeah, thank you.
My point was going to be that a broad brush 25% wouldn't be an appropriate way to deal with it, because there are itemised entries, and to the extent they're done is a moot point now. But my comment would be that if the registrar is considering reductions to time, to bear in mind that my submission is that those reductions should be against the full 100% figures rather than the 50% figures, because then if you're looking at the work in the round, what the judge has said is that our client is entitled to recover not more than 50% of its total costs. So we say, in pure number terms, that cannot be more than 57,498.60. But when you're looking at maybe making adjustments to the time spent,
mm-hmm.
you look at it as a whole against the 114, and then whichever adjustments you may make, they are
exactly
filtered down to the 50% value. So it's not a case of you start at 50% and then you work down from 57,000. You sort of start at 114, work your way down, and then it can't be more than 57.
Yeah, understood.
I don't know if the registrar wants me to address him on Mr. Bowden's points on proportionality and the breach.
No, okay.
And I'm ready and prepared to work through, you know, I can comment on the type of waiting and travelling time, but I think my sir has the point.
No, it's okay.
And the only other point, really, I may make would be, if you just give me 1 second. I mean, in terms of, I would like to make a point in terms of how the application came about again and why it was as it was, and what Mr. Bowden says about conduct. I think the reality is that our clients were compelled to apply for this relief that they did at the time based on a real risk that monies would be paid by the 11th of November when they were ordered to be paid by Banks Housing. There was a real fear that those monies would be dissipated in the hands of my opponent's clients. That is the reason the application was brought. It wasn't simple, it wasn't straightforward. It's an interim but substantive remedy in this court. It's not straightforward to obtain such interim relief over monies when there's five or six parties involved. My learning friend, I appreciate, wasn't employed by his by-hander at the time, he wasn't here, but he referred to the fact that his firm made a cross-application challenging jurisdiction, raising all sorts of other points which were occupied some of the hearing, but also there's sort of a large part of the submissions that came after the hearing, which the judge ordered would be enlightening only. He dismissed all of those applications on jurisdiction and other issues they raised. He found in our favour, my client's favour on the application. It was not an order given by consent. The judge had to give the order. He retired, adjourned for the parties to seek if they could reach agreement on the terms of the order. There was no agreement. The judge was asked to make the order. He did, and he found an order in my client's favour. That's how it panned out. We said there was no other way it could have happened based on the circumstances that led to the application notice in the first place. My opponent's clients simply were not compliant with their obligations under the contract. That's for another day, that's for another judge. That's the reason it worked out as it did. And that is why I say that context is relevant to the work that was therefore required in consequence to actually get this thing going very quickly. We waited until the last possible moment, reasonably we felt we could wait to bring this application. And when the trigger was pulled, work had to be done, and that's the work that you see reflected here. And I say for $11.5 million, that's not at all unreasonable and disproportionate. And I think I'll close my submission there.
Yeah.
So there were some new matters raised by my learned friend, which I have noted and briefly wish to address.
Okay.
And that was number one, choice of counsel. It's their subjective choice. But on analysis here, it's an objective one. Simple as that. I'm sure, sir, in reading the extrajudicial writings of the Chief Justice, that he's very keen to develop the local bar, sir. And I'm not sure you can take that into account, but my learned friend's submission that it's somehow always appropriate to rush off to England is a rather old-fashioned colonialist notion, sir, and not one which fits with the ethos of this court. And to the extent that can be reflected, sir, as a matter of policy, I understand that it is a policy, at least of the Chief Justice, it should certainly be counted down. I did have the opportunity to have a look at the part two list, and Allegheny Emerson, Christopher Mills, Miss Sheaf, Boom Love, Mark Bethwich, Welsh name, I presume, sir.
Best Weatherick.
Thank you. Michael Gross, Robert Marr, Rebecca Ford, and I thought Mr. Bell was a part two practitioner as well. So, there's a host of people that could have been brought in. My name from being brought up for the first time, sir, that in analysing the HAS bill, I don't come to understand why that, sir. If that was subject to analysis, I know it came in at half the amount that my learned friend's estimate, but who says, sir, that would survive any sort of analysis either? And so it's not an appropriate diet. The very last point, sir, that was one that I was minded to appeal to object to, sir, and that is that I think we've taken through the correspondence, but this matter was certainly not set down with concurrence of myself, sir, in the letter saying, okay, we can have a hearing. The letter dated the 21st of September, sir, and which is on tab, I think, two, the two correspondence bundles, sir.
Of your correspondence bundle?
Yes, my correspondence bundle.
Yeah.
Sir. Quite simply, if we turn to the email of the 21st of September, sir. Email correspondence, 21st of September. Indeed, sir. A rehash of matters first mentioned in March, later mentioned in June, mentioned on that day, on the 20th of September, mentioned again, sir, later under tab 2 on the next day, the 21st of September, finally mentioned again on the 12th of October, and indeed, sir, brought up today. It can't be said that anyone consented to that. It was a very qualified consent. We're not trying to obstruct the process of the court, but we go along and we haven't got the information we need, it's going to be a very unsatisfactory year, which in some respects it has been, sir, but not in no small part, sir, owing to your own skills as a chairman of such debates, sir, we've got through. The next point, sir, is this, and just on the final, very last point, where it said that I haven't heard any criticism of the matter set out in the 24 June documents, the document you're talking to, sir. Well, anything that starts with various or to all attendances is practically incapable of analysis. And that was my point, sir. I couldn't, I wasn't analysing it because it couldn't be done. And that's all I wish to say. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Did we manage to find anything? Judge had asked for it. Okay, so it's been confirmed that the judge was involved in listing on the 6th, so that takes that away. Well, look, I can't say I've been enormously helped on this, but I've done the best that I can, having analysed the information that we've got. My sense is that Mr. Hughes's rate for the purposes of assessment should come down to the rate that would be the average rate applied in the DIFC at the time. So if I've understood this table correctly, it would go down from $570 an hour to $432.65. Ordinarily, I would have expected much of the work that Mr. Hughes did to be done. Not much of it, actually, that's too much. I'd certainly expect some of the work that Mr. Hughes would do to be done at a more junior level in the firm. But equally, I accept that where matters are urgent, it is normal for the team to... It's all hands on deck. And to bring new people in can actually add cost and not reduce cost, and it can add inefficiency and not add efficiency. So I'm going to allow all of Mr. Hughes's time, 51.4 hours at the rate of $432.65 or 1,590 dirhams. And I quote those numbers from the schedule here, assuming they're correct. Mr. Hutchison, as the supervising partner, I'd expect you to have less time than Mr. Hughes by quite some measure. And I think that 40.9 hours, whilst clearly spent, is not something that I think ought to be passed on. And I'll reduce your hours to 35 hours. Where I am having some difficulty is in the 24 hours or so of Mr. Emerson's time. He is, as you say, a highly respected now consultant of the, or at the time consultant of the firm, and therefore for strategic input, I can see how his time would be invaluable. But I think that 24 hours, which is the equivalent of three solid working days, is it's not reasonably proportionate to pass that on to the other side. So I reduce the amount of time I'd expect Mr. Emerson to have been involved to 15 hours. We then have the question of Overseas Council. This is a vexing one. I think Mr. Bowden made some strong points in that regard. There are available counsel here in Dubai, and I was under the impression that they may not have been contacted. There are indeed capable counsel within Clyde & Co and capable counsel in other firms who are available to be used in cases. So the question is whether counsel's fees should be allowed. The submission by Mr. Hutchison was that counsel ultimately saved cost, and in a case of this nature, I think that's probably right. And I think the £17,500 seems to me to be a reasonable and proportionate brief fee. The difficulty we have, though, is on the request for the flights for council to come out. Mr. Bowden has steered me towards the suggestion that the Chief Justice would like to encourage the local bar. I'm not sure that's a matter for today, laudable as it clearly is. And the decision is whether or not we should allow the costs of the flight of the council to come out. If this matter had not been as urgent as it was, and possibly, although I'm not attracted entirely to the proportionality point, but if it hadn't involved such a large sum of money, which potentially could have been in jeopardy, I'm not sure I would have allowed the flight cost. But because of the nature of this specific case, on balance again, And it is a narrow balance, but on balance, I would allow the travel costs of council to come out. I'd be grateful if the receiving party could total up the final amounts for the purposes of a cost order. You don't need to do it now.
It's something that we can provide you with subsequent to the hearing.
Thank you.
We can share it with my friend to agree that.
Thank you. And clearly, there's a 50% the Judge Elmar's discount to be considered when running the numbers.
May I just raise one further point? Do I take it that Your Honour has decided that my contention for a further reduction is not a matter that you are going to decide?
My view is that your suggestion in relation to conduct pre His Excellency's order is something that would have been a matter for His Excellency when he considered the percentage of cost to be borne, where I do believe that your point has weight is when we turn to who should bear the costs of this detailed cost process and the conduct that's been undertaken by both sides actually in getting us here today, and that's a matter that we ought to turn to. Right.
I'm grateful, sir. If that concludes your order on the substantive assessment points, I understand you now wish me to address you on the costs of the costs.
Costs of the costs. Have you had the chance to have a chat about those? I don't want to launch into it if you haven't had 5 minutes to talk about it.
No, we haven't. And if the court thinks it would be of assistance, it may be to see where we can reach to on that. Our cost statement is around $20,000, I recall, if it's at tab, which was filed. So
is that in the bundle?
So it was served, it was filed and served. I don't know if it's made its way into your bundle, so I can give you a copy here.
Thank you.
As filed and sealed.
Well, have you got yours?
Yes, I have.
Can I have a look at that as well?
I must have known instinctively that I wasn't going to succeed. I didn't bring it.
I wouldn't go that far. Not yet.
It's only half
done, isn't it? Yeah. Do you have it with you?
I've seen it.
That's okay, Mr. Because if I'm going to leave you to have a chat for 5 minutes or so, you need to know where each of you are coming from.
I'll get it.
Well, I think Aisha's got to print one out for us.
Thank
so you take that one.
Yeah.
And then do you want to have a...
I
think there is a lot of strength in what you said, Mr. Bowden, in terms of how we've got to where we are today, and equally, I'm sure there'll be some strength in the counter position. So, do you want to have a chat about it? See where you get to.